the issue at Meenan isn't actually sort of dressing room divisions. It is general crapness, which, but I don't think, it's something where you've got cliques and camps and whatever else. So the stuff with the tables, it's a good story. We in the press, like, oh, look. But you know what? It's not like he invented the long table. People have been doing this before. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't work. And, again, it all depends on the nature of the club and the dressing room. I think he makes sense for certainly. I thought Spalletti would be a horrendous choice, mm-hmm. and the fact that he was being considered really should worry people. If he was indeed being considered, they were very cagey when they were asked about it.
They were very cagey. Won't
confirm or deny. I almost kind of feel if this isn't Spalletti's people putting the story out. Maybe they just had a phone call and then it became something much bigger. But I think Pioli fits primarily because he pushes kids. He's a company man, so he will take the instruction of, hey, look, we spent a lot of money in this Benacer guy. Play him. Let's find out if Conti can play, if Calabria can play, all these guys that you have to push. So he fits that way. He fits in the fact that he's been at big clubs with a lot of pressure before, which Giampaolo hadn't, mm-hmm. and big clubs in Italy with a lot of pressure, which I think also matters. If you've got a strong director of football, if you come in the summer and you do things right, you can get away with somebody who's making the leap up. If you come in mid-season, I think there is value in that, in somebody who knows the culture, understands the culture, and is used to the pressures that come onto him. And that, I think, is what made him appealing. And the other thing is his football. He counterpressed when he was at Fiorentina. Mm-hmm. His idea of football has evolved over time. He's on top of new ideas, and he fits the kind of football that they want to play.
Yeah, well, I think that's an interesting point, because, one of the reasons why he's so keen about players getting together and why he's, about the dining room situation is that he's one of the few guys who really, well, actually he's not one of the few guys, he's one of the many, who wants a team that doesn't rely on any stars, and which is good, because let's be honest, if you look at Milan, there isn't really any, yeah? So he's the kind of guy who, for example, when he comes in, he's the normalizer, right? Like when he came into Inter, they had De Boer before him, mm-hmm. and it was all a little bit of a mess because it was this philosophy that was going wrong. And he comes in and sort of taps into the instincts of the players he has and tries to make the most of what he's been given in that sense. And the team were at the time very dependent on Icardi scoring, whereas he made Inter a side that scored from all avenues. And I think that's important for Pioli. He wants the whole team to be involved. He wants them to score goals from, it's not going to be focused around Piontek or Leao or whoever it is. It's a case of let's get this team together. Suso likes to be on the wing, but at the same time, he's not necessarily a guy that maybe we'll dribble the ball past 15 different players. So let's see how we can extract the value of all the players that we have and get this into a team unit where everyone is willing to sacrifice for one another. I think that's all you can really ask for from Milan right now, because there aren't the individuals who can perhaps give you the quality that you need. And wherever he's been, he's always gotten, he got the best out of Candreva. He really has helped Chiesa develop into the player that he is. He knows how to work with different strikers, from Miroslav Klose in terms of positioning, who knows how to do that, Icardi being one of those main strikers, or other ones who know how to sacrifice for the team. He's a guy who knows how to work with everyone, youngsters and older players, and just really just get the team together and sort of let them tap into their instincts and perhaps not boggle them down with all the instructions that Giampaolo did.
I think it's interesting when we sort of talk about footballing philosophy. I think you guys have both absolutely nailed it with Pioli. He seems to be extremely flexible. He's someone who has adapted his game. If you go back and look at his master's thesis at Coverciano, it's all about a 4-4-2, which he hasn't played in years, which gives you some indication of a guy who's willing to change. I think of course, there was that cute line when Giampaolo took over as manager, because Antonio Conte had come in and said, my philosophy is head down and pedal. And Giampaolo gave what would have been a great answer if his team could have done it, which is heads up and play football. And they asked Pioli. Now, Pioli is actually, he's a big cyclist. That's like a thing. Like he loves being on his bike in his real life. And they asked him the same question. And he said, I just want to win, which I think feels like what Milan need right now. The thing which I guess we maybe haven't asked yet is, in tangible terms, what changes in this team? I mean, they were already playing 4-3-3 the last couple of games under Giampaolo. You think that's going to stay? Do you think we get something different?
I mean, I think it's tough to say ahead of the Lecce game. In fact, I think even beyond the Lecce game, my understanding is they're going to really evaluate what they have. But I think one of the one of the reasons he was brought in, again, you touched upon it, playing, working with young players. He had the youngest team in Serie A last year at Fiorentina, and Milan are theoretically the youngest team again this year. So I think what changes is you could see 4-2-3-1 even. You know, you could see, I think he's going to try to put people in the positions that they belong in. Mm. I personally would love to see Bennacer and Kessié in front of the back four. I think he's going to give faith to Theo, which, you know, as long as he stays on the level. I think we might see Paqueta in the trequartista role behind the strikers, or maybe Jack. You know, I'm still a big Captain Jack fan. But I don't think Piontek's place is assured at all. Like, I don't think he would have any problem whatsoever putting Lau in there. And I think we'll finally see your pal, Mr. Rebic, who, you know, nobody...
He's always our pals.
Well, you know what? I thought Rebic was vastly underrated. Oh, sorry, vastly overrated for a long time. But I got to see this guy play, uh-huh. Right? I got to see what he can contribute. Obviously, at Eintracht, when, you know, you're playing with Haller and Jovic and they're attacking all the time, that's fantastic, right? Now you're in a different setting. Let's see if you can do it. But, you know, he hasn't been given a shot. So, like, would a front three of Rebic, Lau, and Suso super excite me? Hey, more so than seeing Piontek just standing there with his hands on his hips, yeah.
Thanks so much for watching ESPN on YouTube. And for more sports highlights and analysis, be sure to download the ESPN app. And for premium content and live streaming, subscribe to ESPN+.